G'day, Chris here, and welcome back to Clickspring. I'm in the process of fastening the curbs to the main plate of the Antikythera mechanism. These are the curved metal strips that help to stabilise the larger rotating assemblies. Three underneath the main solar drive wheel were held in place with pins, but the remainder were held in place with soft solder. The scan of one joint in particular shows the full extent of what was achievable at the time. A thin layer of solder that has for the most part run quite well throughout the join. And it tells us a great deal, because although the tools and materials may have evolved, the requirements for a good solder join were exactly the same 2,000 years ago as they are today. Above all, the joint surfaces must have been clean of contaminants. A flux of some description was used to allow the solder to wet the metal surface. The joint was fabricated to be close to allow the capillary force to draw the liquid solder inside. And for the solder to flow easily, the part and the surrounding area must have been raised to a temperature somewhat above the solder melting point. Now the main plate of the mechanism is a substantial heatsink, and for the most part the components are unrestrained and so easily knocked out of position. So it's clear that the maker had a means of applying substantial heat to a specific work area that also permitted gentle application of the solder. And the challenge is to achieve the same result using the tools and materials known to have existed at the time. So starting with the heat source, the ancients had considerable experience working copper and well understood its properties. So I think it's likely that the hot tools were indeed made from copper, and in all likelihood resembled what we would describe as an old school soldering iron. The solder may well have been applied using the tip of the bit, but the nature of the parts suggests to me that the bits were probably just the heat source, and that the solder was more likely touched into the join from the side. So after a bit of testing, I've settled on a collection of old style copper bits, along with some larger copper blocks. The smaller bits allow me to more precisely direct the heat where it's needed, and I've made them quite long and narrow to reach down inside the small gaps between the blocks. The blocks are larger and so act as a broader heat source to raise the temperature of the general work area. They can also be left cold and so act as a heat sink to protect a part that's already been soldered into position. Now, I've mentioned in previous videos that I think abrasives played a big role in the construction of the mechanism. In this case, I'm using powdered pumice on a damp cloth to reveal fresh metal. But it's not enough to simply clean off the surface and leave it at that. As the metal is heated, oxides quickly reform on the surface and work to repel the solder. It sits on top of the oxide layer as a sort of paste, and no amount of heat will make it flow on the metal underneath. So in addition to being clean, a flux is required to chemically reduce the oxide and allow the metal to wet the surface. And there are two types of flux to consider, passive and active. The classic active flux is a dilute zinc chloride solution formed from hydrochloric acid and zinc, otherwise known as killed spirits. Now the use of killed spirits can be traced back many hundreds of years, and so today we consider it to be quite traditional. But I've yet to find a source establishing its use as far back as antiquity. So, despite it being an excellent flux, for now I'm leaving it out of contention. Of the passive fluxes, tallow is well documented as being used in the period, but I think the more likely contender is rosin. Otherwise known as Greek pitch, or by its regional name of colophony, rosin would have been readily available during the period of the mechanism's construction, and it's a superbly effective flux still in widespread use today. It also has the benefit that it's easy to work with and control. With the gentle heat, it can be manipulated into a convenient shape for ready application to the work area. And the last material to consider is of course the solder. Now we don't know the exact composition of the alloy used in the mechanism, but the radio-dense nature of the join suggests a lead-based solder. And I think a 60-40 tin lead alloy is a reasonable starting point. Again, the charcoal fire can be used to heat the raw components until molten, and it's easily solidified into conveniently held shapes for later use. Okay, so that's everything required. Time to give it a go and see how it all performs. I'm using a naturally aspirated charcoal fire to heat the tools. And the first thing to mention is just how labour-intensive and resource-hungry it is. it takes a lot of time and charcoal to get the tools to the required temperature, and it takes a fair amount of work to keep the fire well tended and hot. Of course, the heat immediately starts to leave the tools as soon as they're removed from the coals, so I found I needed to work fairly quickly to get the best results, and also that planning the sequence of events was important. Everything needs to be close to hand to keep the process flowing and make the best use of the heat. For the larger pieces, it also helped to break the job into two parts. First, by heating up the plate enough to flow the rosin, and then dropping the part into its general position. At this elevated temperature, the rosin stays tacky for a few minutes, allowing a more careful positioning of the part, after which the hot tools were returned to run the solder into the join. Now, there's no doubt that this is a very different way of working compared to the modern process. But for all the differences, it's the similarities that are the most striking. Because no matter the tools or methods used, it all still comes down to seeing that tiny flash of silver as the solder runs around the seam, indicating a good join. Somewhere in the distant past, either by accident or design, someone saw that flash of silver and recognised its potential. The process of how to best make it happen was mastered and then passed on, until it eventually became part of the workshop tradition that led to not just the Antikythera mechanism, but also much of the technology that followed it. So that even now, thousands of years later, soft solder remains one of the easiest and most common methods for joining metal. Thanks for watching. I'll see you later.